Now I'll be looking at questions on arguments which come from the area of reasoning. Now arguments is nothing but, as the question type says, you have to find out whether an argument for a particular thing is strong or weak. So there is a black and white thing which is expected from you here, which says that the argument is strong or it has to be weak. Now if an argument is not strong, then it is supposed to be weak. There is no in between. So even if there is a bit of ambiguity in that argument, you would assume that it's a weak argument. Okay, so we'll see the directions. The question states that in making decisions about important questions, it is desirable to be able to distinguish between strong and weak arguments as they relate to the questions. Strong arguments are those which are important and directly related to the question. On the other hand, weak arguments are not much important and they does not relate directly to the questions. Each question below is followed by two arguments, number 1 and 2. And you have to decide if both of them or either of them or none of them is strong and which one is weak. And there are options which are given. So option 1, if only argument 1 is strong. Option 2, if only argument 2 is strong. Option 3, if either 1 or 2 is strong. Option 4, if neither 1 nor 2 is strong. And option 5, if both 1 and 2 are strong. Now, option 3 is very important here, if either 1 or 2 is strong. So generally what happens is that statement will be followed by two arguments. Sometimes they are contrasting. So if something is given, if the question is, should you be admitted to your dream institute? And if the answer is yes, because you have worked very hard, and no, because you haven't worked very hard, or whatever. If both the arguments are balancing and they are opposite of each other, then you will mark either 1 or 2 is strong, right? So the difference between either 1 or 2 is strong and both 1 or 2 are strong is that if both 1 and 2 are strong, both of them imply the same thing, right? So if first argument says that yes, you should be admitted because you have worked very hard, and the second argument says that yes, you should be admitted to a good institute because you have taken, say for example, 20 mocks, then both those arguments are strong because you have worked very hard to attain your goal, right? So if both of them point towards the same thing, then you will say that both 1 and 2 are strong. Again, vice versa, if the question is that should you be admitted to your dream institute, no, you shouldn't be admitted because you do not really have awareness about what you want to do after you get into that institute is the first statement. And no, you should not be admitted because you haven't really put in an effort and others are preparing much harder than what you are, right? So if both the statements are again true, both of them are negatives, but both of them are true, right? So both of them are against the argument and both of them are strong, then you will say that both 1 and 2 are strong, right? But if the question states that should you be admitted to your dream institute, if the first statement says yes, you should be admitted to your dream institute because you have worked very hard and you are very sure of what your goals are and how to achieve them, okay, that is the first statement. The second statement says that no, you should not be admitted to your dream institute because there are a lot of people who are more aware of their goals and they are preparing a lot harder and are of better aptitude than you are, right? So in case you are arguing, either of these arguments are true because both of them are strong. So either 1 is strong or 2 is strong. Yes and no cannot be equally strong, okay? So if these two arguments are opposing each other, if they are in the form of yes and no, then you will choose either. And if both of them are in the form of yes or both of them are in the form of no, then you will choose that both of them are. Okay, so this is a very big difference between either or and both 1 and 2, because this is very critical when it comes to tests and people get confused and lose out on marks because of an issue with understanding these two things. Because during an exam, it is very easy for you to forget either or and both, and you can get confused and probably mark one for the other and lose out on easy marks. So be very clear, if either or has to be present, then yes, no has to be present. If both 1 and 2 are strong, then both of them should point towards the same argument. Okay, so both should be yeses or both should be noes. So the question is pretty straightforward. Again, it's a very subjective question. So there are chances that your thought process and the paper setter's thought process might not really match, which is fair and which will lead to a lesser accuracy in this question. So out of a set of say 5 questions, you can expect 3 or 4 questions to be answered correctly. So 60-80% accuracy is fair enough in this section. The good thing is, again, as was the case with assumptions, you can sift through these questions very quickly. The entire set will not take more than 2 or 3 minutes to solve. But then again, you will get 3 or 4 marks in that entire set, which is again a fair share. So if you are getting 1 mark per minute, as was your plan to start with, then you are doing pretty well for this part of the paper. So again, expectation of accuracy could be a bit lower, but you can move through these questions really quickly. Okay. So we'll have a look at a couple of questions to help you understand in a better manner. So the first question says that The first statement says that should the government bring a bill to ban child birth? So this is taken from an actual paper. So the grammatical mistakes are there, which were there in the paper. So should the government bring a bill to ban child birth is what the gist of the question is. So it says that there is probably a problem, an issue with the increasing population, and so should the government bring a bill to ban child birth? Okay. So the arguments are, again, if you look at it just superficially, you can see that one argument says yes, the other argument says no. So it's a yes no question, so you cannot really say that both 1 and 2 are strong if it comes to that. So it should be either 1 or 2 is strong, both if standard argument 1 or argument 2 is strong, and if neither of them is strong. Okay. So the argument says yes, because of frequent population growth, it is the only way to control population. Now, if it is said that because of frequent population growth, it is the only way to control population, then it doesn't really make sense. Okay, the government bringing a ban on childbirth is an extreme step, and it has probably never been done in the history of mankind. So, it's very difficult to regulate this thing. Okay, and you cannot really say that this is the only way to control population. There could be other ways. You could spread awareness. You could even people would realize it if the prices increase, or if there is a penalty, say for example, on subsequent childbirth, as is practiced in this country as well. As in, a government will provide certain things during the first and second childbirth, and subsequently they might withdraw some of the things that assist these people, and so that is something which can be used to curb population. So banning childbirth is an extreme step, and the first statement does not really justify it. It simply says the cause, because of frequent population growth, it is the only way, so which is not really true, and we cannot really say that it is a strong argument. It sounds pretty superficial. Okay, so we will say that the first argument is not really a strong argument, and so we will let it go at the moment. The second argument says that no, this is not possible at all. What government can do is that it should allow couples to have attractive awards like government jobs and monthly income, etc., if they go for just one issue. So what they mean here is that the government can do is the government can have attractive awards like government jobs and whatever the people are looking for. So basically it's a carrot and stick kind of a thing which is being discussed here. The second thing says that no, it is not possible, which is again true. You cannot ban childbirth. Childbirth is a physiological process which will be carried out, which will happen even if the government has stringent measures to curb that thing. Even if the government withdraws all the hospitals, even then people will find a way to deliver a child, and so it cannot really be eliminated completely, right? The second thing says that no, it is not possible at all, which is perfectly logical. What government can do is that it can allow people to have awards if they can go for just one kid. So which is again a good thing, which is again a good suggestion which has been given. So a rewarding experience is present. This is a strong argument, which is sensible, which can be carried out on a large scale. The first argument is a radical thing, and again when it comes to strong and weak arguments, you cannot really be radical in your thought process. You cannot really be thinking about only one particular stakeholder, right? Government is a stakeholder, but again the parents of the child or the general population, that is also a stakeholder, and you cannot really say that you should ban childbirth again because ban childbirth completely, because then again it will have repercussions on your economy, it will have repercussions on the kind of environment that you are staying in, it will have repercussions on job opportunities or education opportunities and so on. So you cannot really ban it. So that is a radical argument which is being presented. You have to have a balanced argument which takes into account all the stakeholders, which is something which you can deliver to a lot of people, almost the entire population. So whenever you are looking for strong arguments, just make sure that they are morally correct, they are politically correct, they are socially correct, and you can deliver this verdict in a room in which all the stakeholders are sitting. Okay, so this is not really something which you will think to yourself and you will mark it, but this is something which you will deliver to a lot of people, you will deliver to a lot of stakeholders who are present in your vision. So you have to be extremely careful when you are delivering such a verdict. So in this case, the second argument sounds fair, and so we'll mark option 2, which says that the second argument is strong. So this argument is strong, and then it makes sense because it is balanced. It also thinks about rewarding, so it is not really a negation kind of a thing that no, this is not possible, but it gives some insights, and it gives some things which could be possible and which could be carried out so that the population is curbed. Okay, so you have to go for a balanced argument, which we are doing in this case. Now, going to question 2, the statement is, should the government rely on the recent statements and promises of Pakistan President Parvez Musharraf? So again, this is an old question, so it is not related to something which is going on right now. So should the government rely on the recent statements and promises of Pakistan President Parvez Musharraf is the statement. The arguments, again, it is in the form of yes, no. So again, you cannot really say that both of them are strong. So the first statement says that no, it is their new cheating policies to hit their targets. Again, it's a very vague statement and it's grammatically not correct. But again, this was what appeared in the paper, so we are taking it from there. Yes, this time Parvez Musharraf's attitude has shown new ways to improve Indo-Pak relationships. If anything, the first statement is again radical in nature. It says that it is a cheating policy or they are cheating something, which we cannot really say if it's true or not, right? It's a statement which is being made without any background as such. And so we cannot really say that the first statement is true, whatever you feel in your heart, right? Again, you cannot really sit in front of the entire population of India, the entire population of Pakistan and deliver a verdict saying that you are cheating us of something. It's an accusation, it cannot be an argument. Okay, so there is a subtle difference between these two things. So the first one cannot really be, it's not really correct, whatever has been said. And the second thing which is said that, yes, this time Parvez Musharraf's attitude has shown new ways to improve Indo-Pak relationships. And so, again, it is being said that the attitude has shown some change. So there is a background to it. So this time his attitude has shown new ways to improve Indo-Pak relationships. And that is why we can rely on the recent statements and promises of Pakistan President Parvez Musharraf. So this makes perfect sense. The second argument which is being presented makes perfect sense. So irrespective of your personal bias has to be set aside when you're dealing with questions. Even if you feel something about Pakistan or Parvez Musharraf or whatever the statements are or whatever is being propagated by the media, you should not form an opinion on that. So this is not a general knowledge a part of the paper, right? This is something which is a logical reasoning kind of a paper section. So that's why you should eliminate all personal bias that you have, and probably you should look at it from a neutral point of view. That is something which a manager has to do, or whatever your designation will be, you will have to handle people, or you will have to execute certain deliverables. So you should look at it from an objective angle, not in a subjective angle. So this is something which is being expected from this question. So in this case, again, because statement 2 is backed with sufficient reasoning, which says that his attitude has shown new ways to improve. That's why we can take it on face value, saying that because his attitude has shown, that's why we can rely on his recent actions and promises. So that is something which goes hand in hand. So this is something which can be justified. So in case of strong and weak arguments, again, as I mentioned right at the start, this is extremely subjective. You might disagree with the paper setter, but that doesn't make your answer correct. So you have to be balanced morally, politically, socially. You have to be correct. You should be able to answer, you should be able to give this argument in front of all the stakeholders, not really sitting in your office or thinking in your head. You should not be able to give this verdict, but you should be able to give this verdict in front of all the stakeholders. If you can do that, then that is the correct answer. If you cannot do that, then probably it's not really a strong argument. In case of ambiguity, always vote for the weak argument, because generally the argument which is not able to satisfy you, that is not really a strong argument, and so you can safely say that it's a weak argument and you can go to the next statement which is present. And that is how you solve these questions. So again, there is no black and white or right and wrong or an exactly strong or a perfectly weak argument. But then again, you have to use a discretion. You have to use whatever data has been provided. And you have to not make any assumptions when you are dealing with these question types. I hope your some doubts regarding arguments or strong and weak argument questions have been cleared in this video. You can have a look at our other videos as well. Thank you.